We'll go right to item B, review and follow-up regarding any issues addressed at the work session on Monday, December 7th.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. There's two issues for follow-up. Mayor Moore requested a follow-up concerning the number of out-of-state vehicles within the city. We spoke to Deputy Chief Salerno, and the police department will continue to validate current registration and issue violations as required, but they can't seek where a vehicle will be garaged, stored, or legally parked, especially in on-street parking. There was a concern from the public about the number of vehicles parked along Deal Lake that appear to be commercial vehicles without designated plates, and the number of vehicles that are parked are taking two spaces in order to, quote-unquote, save a parking space. Again, the police department requested more information on this. If they're legally parked vehicles and they meet the requirement, which is mostly weight, then they can park legally. If they replace one vehicle with another vehicle to save a space like that, like such as that, they are within the law. Nevertheless, the traffic division has been alerted to look for these violations. That's all the follow-up I have. Thank you.
Any matters by the City Council?
I don't have any.
Anybody?
No.
Just a friendly reminder, if you don't have it, sign up for Nixle, please. January 1st, no code red, so sign up for Nixle.
Free parking 12 to 6 on Saturdays in Asbury Park through the end of December.
Anybody else? Matters by the city manager?
None at this time.
Matters by the city attorney? Motion to close workshop?
Move it.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All right. Got 14 minutes. Regular session of the Asbury Park City Council meeting. Councilmember Clayton?
Here.
Councilmember Kendall?
Here.
Councilmember Warner?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
Would everybody please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please? Flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided to the following manner. The adult notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster, and the Star Ledger on January 2nd, 2015, and posted on bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. Next item is a proclamation recognizing Reverend William E. Coleman, Jr.
Danny Hosta.
Reading the proclamation. All right. Whereas Reverend William E. Coleman, Jr., Associate Minister at Shiloh Baptist Church, Trent, New Jersey, and for the past 3 years has served as the interim pastor of Asbury Park Second Baptist Church. Pastor Coleman dropped out of high school and entered the U.S. Army to serve this country, and upon his discharge from military service, went on to obtain his GED, earned a Bachelor of Arts degree in Psychology and Human Behavior from John Jay College of Criminal Justice. A master's degree in planning and public administration from the City University of New York, Baruch College, where he was a National Urban Fellow. A Master of Arts degree in theology and pastoral care from New Brunswick's Theological Seminary, and was ordained a Baptist minister. William E. Coleman, Jr. began his professional career as a New York City police officer and eventually promoted to the rank of detective and served as a training specialist, providing sensitivity training at the New York City Police Academy, and has conducted workshops and seminars on such diverse topics as interpersonal skills, value clarification, sensitivity and cultural diversity, team building and conflict resolution. Reverend Coleman, a published author, currently serves as the chaplain at St. Francis Hospital, has served as a trustee and president of the National African American College, trustee of Mercer County Community College, has Essex County Community College, and organized the Brookdale Community College First Minority Male Initiative to help improve college graduation rates for minority males. Now therefore be it resolved that the mayor and council members of the city of Asbury Park do hereby acknowledge Reverend William E. Coleman Jr. for his many accomplishments and contributions to our country, the great state of New Jersey, the residents of Asbury Park, and the congregation at Second Baptist Church.
I'm Dan Harris, Deacon of Second Baptist Church in Asbury Park, but I'll be going back to a meeting. Still don't walk out of here, but on behalf of Reverend Coleman, I did talk to him this afternoon. His wife, Bonnie Watson Coleman, who is the first African-American congressperson in New Jersey. So right now, Reverend Coleman is attending all the parties. It goes with having your wife being a congressperson in Washington, D.C. And I said, I ain't mad at you. But he did send his thanks and his respect. And he said, even though he's leaving Asbury because he's going to be spending most of his time in D.C., he will still be connected with Asbury. He's been very influential to our church and to the community. And on behalf of Reverend Coleman, Congresswoman Bonnie Watson Coleman, and the congregation of St. Matthew's Church, I thank you very, very much.
And there's a luncheon Saturday, but it's sold out. Right, Danny?
Yeah, it's sold out.
It's sold out. So we're scalping tickets.
It is sold out. You're going to be there, right?
Yes, sir. It doesn't get read twice.
It took me a half hour to read that.
All right, can I have a motion to open the meeting to the public with a 3-minute time limit, please?
Move it. Second.
All in favor? All opposed? The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order, and after appropriate warning, may terminate any further comments from the speaker. Each speaker has 3 minutes to speak, and when you do come up to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
Yeah, back to the, yeah, just, oh. Yeah. Oh. Yeah, but you can go back there and line up if you want.
Come on down. Hi, Warner Baumgartner, 5th Avenue. I'd like to talk a little bit about a public safety issue. You know, technology evolves over time, and with the very easy access to really high-intensity lighting that we see now today in the big box stores, the average homeowner can buy a very cheap, really, really bright floodlight and throw it up on his house and point it wherever he likes. It's causing a real issue in town. If you ride the streets, you'll see these lights going up. They're really bright, they're glary, they're kind of bluish white, and they really destroy your ability to see at night. I raise this because it's really a public safety issue. It's contrary to what common sense would dictate. People think putting bright lights up and shining them out into the public is a good thing. Really, it's a bad thing. All the evidence, all the professional associations, all the science behind it indicates that doing that actually makes the streetscape less safe because you can't see. It blinds people. Creates a very hazardous condition. Pedestrians walking across the street aren't visible because of glare from lights like this. It creates dark shadows that people can hide in that are possibly looking to mug somebody. I'd like to see something done about this, and I'm at a loss to figure out what entity within the city to address that to. Would it be code? We don't have a lighting code. We should. Would it be the police? It's really not a police matter, perhaps public safety, if there's a specific entity for public safety, or maybe just the courts as a nuisance or something like that. So maybe you could provide some guidance as to where to start taking care of some of these really intrusive lights that are being put up. Perhaps a public education campaign about how to properly utilize really bright lighting. Pointing it down toward the ground, pointing it into areas where the light is needed instead of just out into space, into the public realm. I think the city would really be better off if this were controlled a little bit. So any thoughts on that, folks? I see Jesse shaking his head no. I don't know why.
Michael's going to answer.
Okay.
Thank you, Mayor. We actually spoke about this morning, myself, Warner, and Mr. Keddie met, and Warner brought this up, and I stated to him that this is a design standard as per zoning regulations, and that as we're redoing the master plan, hopefully reexamination report in the upcoming months, that this would be best addressed as design standards. And during the conversation, Warner somewhat agreed to it. He'd like something done sooner than later, but it is a design standard best served in the zoning ordinance.
Great. Anybody else have thoughts on that? Agree? Disagree?
Right.
Okay. Time's up.
Good evening. My name is Leslie Dixon. I'm originally from Asbury Park, but I live in Long Branch right now. And I just want to ask a question. Could someone tell me what's going on with the Westside Community Center? The Westside Community Center?
When you say what's going on, can you?
Yeah, like it's not, is it open? When I grew up, the Westside Community was a place where the youth could go, a safe place where we like played games at, and we had drill teams. It was just an outlet for youth to guide us. You know what I mean? Like instead of all the street violence that's going on right here, right now. You know, it helped us to stay focused, to stay as kids. You know, and I was just wondering, like, is it open for our youth?
It's a great question.
What?
You want to go? Yeah.
I'll start. I agree with you. When I grew up, the Westside Community Center was a safe place for us to be, to go, to get guidance, to do all types of things, to learn how to put on makeup, to take dance lessons. And currently, the Westside Community Center is not truly functioning. And the council has been talking to and working with the Westside Community Center, but so far we have not made much progress. We have reached out to other sources, like for the county, to hopefully give some assistance, financial assistance to the Westside Community Center. But at present, I can't say it's truly functioning.
Okay. In Long Branch, real quick, they have the Bucky James Center, which is like sort of like the Westside Community Center. But my idea would be for the Westside Community Center, it would give the kids after-school programs. It would also give our youth a job all year round, from after-school programs to help the kids with their homework to our children being able to go to camp and recreation, a whole lot of stuff. And it would give these kids in our community somewhere to go besides in the streets killing each other.
We totally agree with you.
And I just have one more thing to say. The YMCA has information that where the children can get free scholarships, a ride to college for free. Our children need this information.
Just for clarification purposes, because we absolutely agree with you, It is a private entity, whether it's a nonprofit 501c3 is a bit up in the air. And last night, unfortunately, there was a member of their board, Reverend Bradley, but what we could do, because I think you should express your feelings to the board and the executive director who run it, is before you leave, give me your email and I will at least get you in contact with the executive director so you could, you know, facilitate some of these ideas.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Which way I go? Yeah, I'm done. My minute.
Mayor, can I throw something out there? Currently, from about 2 years ago, the mayor and council authorized about $50,000 in community development block grant money, CDBG, to do repairs to the center. It was roof, some HVAC issues, possible new basketball flooring. Over the last couple of years, we've been waiting for information from the center. Under HUD rules, HUD has requested us to request information such as financial nonprofit status, and we've been waiting for that information. So once we can get that information from the center, we can then release some money so that they can fix the roof and the basketball court and start operating more services and program. We met with a board member today. We expressed that again, that the mayor and council, administration, staff, the public, let's get this taken care of, because we do want the center to be fully functional. It's been a priority of the mayor and council for a couple of years now. There's some paperwork that has to be done. So we're really just waiting on that.
Are you done?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, I didn't want to interrupt. My name's Bob Obler, and I live in the Post Building, 601 Madison Avenue, and I'm on the board, the condo board, on the Post Building. And we all support the parking change, revisiting it, the money that's going to be collected. We're all in support of it. We understand the financial needs of it. But the reason I'm here is my concern on a potential inequity that, the way I read the ordinance, is going to affect us in the Post Building only. We in the Post Building do not have included parking. We never had included parking. What we had from our developer was parking that was offered. It's a private parking lot. Nothing is included. Nothing was part of our purchase agreements, except that we had the right to park in an open parking lot for whatever the market would bear. So the way I read the ordinance now, we are going to be required to park at least one of our vehicles, since there is, quote, parking available for our building. The other buildings in the Central Business District, I guess that would be the Griffin, the Mercury, and I'll even go to Wesley Grove to indicate they have included parking. Granted, it was probably put into the maintenance agreement or however the developer did it. We don't. We're the only building without designated parking that's included. And if you put your ordinance in, you're going to force us to pay whatever the developer wants. And since Mr. Sackman is a kind man with a big heart, we all know that none of us park there because he asks for too much money. And if your ordinance goes through, we will wind up paying, even at present rates, more than it costs to park in the Bangs Avenue parking garage. Let's say you put 75, Sackman says, I want 100. Maybe next year or next month they'll want 200, and you'll force us to park one car there. So what I am asking you on behalf of the board of the Post Building is to at least allow us, in a building that doesn't have included parking, to have the option to pay for parking for our two vehicles in the Bangs parking lot. We can, you know, we can put one in there now, but under the ordinance we're going to have to give Mr. Sackman the check. And you know, I will say this, and we also have to remember, and I'll say it to the board and I'll be quick, no matter what he tells you, that parking lot is privately owned. He is both the lessor and the lessee. He is the licensee and the licensor. He owns it and he signed for it. So he controls the cost. What I'm asking you, when you put the ordinance through, to give us, call it a waiver, or give us the right to park in the Bangs Building. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's all yours, Rita.
I can give a brief answer.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
So the ordinance as it is written now actually requires that. The issue is a process that we've talked about at the parking meetings. It hasn't been enforced. And the Central Business District land use plan, the plan for that district, very clearly states that the developers for residential properties have a parking requirement, that they need to provide that much parking. I think it's 1.5 for a normal residential unit to the residents. So what we're really trying to do is just, and it's not that's not uncommon in downtowns across the country. So what we're trying to do is the relationship between the tenant and the landlord and parking is just that relationship between the tenant, the landlord, and the parking. It's not necessarily the city's job to deal with that relationship. All we can deal with is our resources, and the priority that we're giving is there are some people downtown in buildings that have no off-street parking at all. They don't have the option to do it at all.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
So the idea was to give those people the priority because they don't have an option at all at the Bangs Ave Garage. If we're down the road and the Bangs Ave Garage isn't full, I think we'd be open to revisit it. But for the people who do have some option to park in, we're asking that one of those spots be used because that's the way the land use plan goes. And then the people who don't, we're trying to provide an option for the people who have no parking at all.
And I don't want to take up too much time, and I don't dispute what you're saying, but the prior council, when they gave the waiver to Sackman's company, and you can go back and look at it, I read it, all they said is he's required to have 27 spaces offered. They never said it had to be included. They never had to say where it was, like you subsequently did with other buildings that were built. And therefore, you caused us the problem where you allowed him to own the property and set whatever rate he wanted and not give us anything, even though it was required. And I understand 27 spots were required, but instead of saying included, you allowed him to say offered, which simply made it a public parking lot. I went through this with a prior council member, and he agreed it was very poorly worded, not for Sackman, but it was poorly worded for us who bought into the place. And I understand what you're saying. I'm just saying we are the only ones who are going to have that disadvantage. Thank you.
Thank you.
So yours, Rita.
That should have been a parking ramp anyway. Yeah. Hi, Rita Moreno, 8th Avenue. I agree with him. If anybody follows the bill resolution, I don't know if anybody in this room does, but I follow it, and it's pretty interesting. It gives all the bills that are being paid every 2 weeks. In the bills, I don't know when it started, maybe about a year ago, there's a list of employees that are in the bill resolution once a month, and they get compensated for their health benefits. Now, tonight I just got the resolution and I'm reading it. When people retire from the city, they get everything that's coming to them. Their sick leave, their vacation, their comp time, whatever it is. So this resolution says if there's anything left over, it goes to their spouse or their children or whoever in the family. I never saw this resolution. I think I've attended 99 and 9/10 council meetings. This never came up. Resolutions get put in the paper, don't they?
No.
They get advertised?
No.
No?
Nope.
Well, this is not even, it doesn't even look like a resolution. This is something that somebody came up with, this idea. And it's a very poor idea, and it's costing us money. This has got to be looked into. This is very serious. Very serious. I mean, like, if you're retiring from the city of Asbury Park and you get everything that's coming to you, and you sign off and you leave, you're telling me that after you leave, you got 5 years to come back and get your sick leave, vacation time, and comp time? Or the spouse? Or the children? There's something wrong with this. And it's got to be looked into. This is very serious. This is like fraud here. That people come in and get this, and you have somebody getting money that's retired about 20 years. I'm not going to mention her name. But I don't know who she's getting it for. She's been out of here a long time, and I think John knows who it is. I mean, this is ridiculous. It's like $20,000, $22,000 in the last bill resolution. And for what? Read this resolution and tell me if it's correct. I don't think anybody in the state of New Jersey has this. And it's got to be looked into. The other thing is about what the man said about the parking. That was supposed to be a parking ramp for everybody. He's got it as a private parking lot. I was here when that happened. How did that happen? That now he charges people to park there when he was supposed to build a parking ramp. And I was here, and Maureen was here. We all were here. He has never built a parking ramp, and he's created this big problem in the city. And nobody gets after him. He keeps getting everything he wants. So I want to know about this resolution. It's not your fault. No, I mean, I'm not blaming anybody
up
there. I'm
going to try to explain to you. I don't even know if Michael knows about it.
So huh?
I'm going to try to explain it to you. I don't have it in front of me. I'm guessing it goes back to 2010.
It does.
It was a proposition proposed by a previous city manager where he was trying to entice people to retire to get people off the payroll. And that was totally illegal. And he took it to the state, and the state said, no, you can't just do it to get people to retire. It has to be across the board for everybody. So when, I'll use myself for example, because I'm one of the 20 people on the list.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to duck that, and I'm surprised it's never come up before. When I went to retire, I had excess days that the city could have either paid me for, because I was due them, or I could create what they called, and I didn't come up with the terminology, I'm just explaining to you, create a bank. The bank was for X amount of thousands of dollars. And I could use that X amount of thousands of dollars to get health benefits for my wife or daughter within 5 years of my retirement, but only to go for 5 years. And you had to do it before age, I forget what it says in there, 62 or something, 60. And that was the program. And when the former city manager proposed this, I think I was one of the, it was called the so-so plan, because the first person that took it, then the second person took it. And I read it by my attorney, and my attorney said, John, you can take it and throw it away. It will never stand up in court unless it's approved by the state and it's done by mayor and council by resolution. So I went back to the city manager and said, no, I'm not taking this deal unless it's done right. The city did it right. And those people are on the list and continue to get on the list because it's always open. Now, if that makes sense or not, probably not, which I can talk to you later about it and try to explain it better. But it's a bank for health benefits for either, once your child becomes 26, your child can't get it to begin with by state law. But so, I'm getting it right now for health benefits for my wife. And my bank will not cover 5 years. But it could, if I had $100,000 in there, it would cover 5 years. But I don't have that in my bank. So each month, my bank is withdrawing whatever that 2 weeks ago bill, that's the one I abstain on all the time. And it's been going on since 2010. Passed by resolution, okayed by the state, and done legally.
Doesn't look like it was okayed by the state. It looks like it was written up and it's got a seal here.
It was okayed by the state because I wouldn't take it unless it was okayed by the state on advice of my attorney.
But how do you calculate your money? How do you calculate comp time after you leave? How is that calculated? I mean, like John Moore, $100,000. How do you figure that out?
Well, they took how many vacation days I had, or comp time I had, and figured out my hourly rate, multiplied it times whatever, and that's what I had. That they could have either paid me in cash then, or spread it out over 5 years down the road.
I don't know. This ought to be passed on up to the state.
Okay, no problem, Rita. Like I say, it's been going on since 2010. Nobody's ever hidden it.
I don't know of any other city that does this. Not one.
You may be right about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see it. Oh, I'm sorry. And that was Mr. Reedy.
Good evening, Council. Frank Syfax, 1403 Bangs Avenue. I just have a question. With the new signs on Bangs Avenue, if it snows that you can't park on that side, Where do you park at when that happens? Maybe we're not getting no snow, I hope not anyway. But anyway, if it does snow, where will we park?
As close to your house as possible.
Okay, it's going to be close to the house, it's not going to be, you know.
No, the closest spot you can find on the opposite side of the street. Or
on the opposite side?
Oh yeah, it's just one side.
So we can clear one side one day and clear the other side the next day.
Okay, so I'm on this side, on the right-hand side, right? Okay, so when it snows... Okay, from the school, okay.
Right,
all right, that's all I need to know.
Yeah, on Bangs, Sunset, and there's the third street, Springwood, it's only on one side of the street.
Right.
So yeah, so you're right, you would park on the opposite side. If that's clogged, then you go one of the side streets, and then the next day swing over, and then
okay.
We can go curve to curve.
Okay, that's all I need to know. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, Calvin Anderson, homeowner 405 First Avenue. My first question is, taxes in Asbury Park is extremely high. I want to know about the civil service jobs. Civil service jobs should go to fire department and police department. Everybody can't be civil service. We're paying a lot of money out. I'm hearing her talking about packages and so forth. We need a break for the homeowners. Second of all, the train station. We need to fix that train station up. Maybe get a high-speed railroad or something, but it's a shame where our train station is. Third, public speaking. Angela had a public speaking program, and it was supposed to be some grant money to help the girls, and we just don't know what happened with that. So I need an explanation for that too, please. Thank you very much.
Certainly.
Okay, are you done, Calvin?
Yes, I'm done.
Okay.
Hey, Calvin, so Angela and I have repeatedly talked about the orator program, and there's a document that she's told me that she's had some trouble getting that the city needs, and as soon as she gets it, she'll give it to us. But that it isn't the city on that. Angela just has to require, I forget, I'm going to use the wrong word, but I'm going to say a business statement. I'm using the wrong name of a document. I talked to Angela. She said it's going to take her a month or two to get it. As soon as she gets it, she'll give it to the city.
I
talked to Angela last week.
I know you talked to her last week. And you know, we talked about the document, Angela and I. You know, the document, which other people didn't give documents. You know, we just need to have a talk about that. You know what I mean? Because you know, we're kind of confused. Okay.
Well, you can certainly have Angela call me. She didn't sound confused when I spoke to her, but if she's confused, of course she can call me. I mean, the document is as per HUD, so our hands are a little bit tied. That's HUD money. But of course Angela can call me and we'll go over the document. I mean, myself and Cassandra have been working with Angela for a while to get her a grant from CDBG.
It's the same predicament as the Westside Community Center. We cannot give them the money until they give us the forms, not because we're nasty, because HUD, who's given us the money, says no, or else we're going to fine you. So
okay, I just like
document,
to.
We can't do anything.
I just like to know what document, because we have some young ladies in this city that deserve that. It's very little money to help with the program, but they need the money to help them with their public speaking.
If she calls Cassandra tomorrow, I'm sure she'll be told exactly what document. As far as the civil service, the entire city's civil service. You can get out of it by referendum?
No, you can't get out of it at all. Once you're in, you're in, and that is it.
And there's talk about reform, but nobody ever does it.
Right. The Senate president is against getting people out of civil service. And okay. It will never happen.
Well,
we're with you on it, though.
Well,
in theory, we agree.
Excuse me, I'm a union man, okay, but civil service jobs are supposed to be for police officers and fire department, not for the entire city. Let me finish. The police officers and fire officers, if they need equipment and so forth, okay, for their budget and so forth, everybody in the city shouldn't be civil service.
That's state law.
It's coming off the back of me, you know, me, the taxpayer. Well, you know, maybe we need to change the resolution or something.
You can't change civil service. There's only 5 unclassified positions now, I think.
Correct.
That aren't within the civil service guidelines and within the union contracts.
Well, I'd like to be provided with that contract so I can have it exploited.
The union contracts?
Yes.
Just send in a request to the clerk and you'll get the...
And not just the union part of it, because I'm a union person, but the civil service part of it.
Civil service is state law. We'll send you everything you need. Just send an Oprah request and we'll direct you exactly where it has to be, because it's all documents. And if you just go to the state of New Jersey's personnel website.
Well, you know, I'm just, you know, personally offended because, you know, I'm, as a taxpayer, I've been taxed 3 times in a row. And you guys keep coming back taxing me, and I'm paying all this, these taxes because all these different types of jobs are being created, and I want to see where my money's going to.
I'm not sure.
I know you're new here.
What jobs are you talking about being created?
There's all kind of jobs. I'm just saying that you're raising my taxes, and I want to know why they're being raised. You know what I mean? My house was assessed several times, okay, and I'm paying a lot of money out. Okay, and I'm for police officers and fire department having equipment and all the money that they need. Okay, but you just can't have everybody can't be civil service within the city. Everybody can't do that. I never saw that before.
It's every civil service municipality in the state.
Well, I like to see that, you know, in writing as everybody does it, because okay. a lot of counties got rid of it.
Okay. Thank you, Calvin.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Louise Murray, Grand Avenue, Asbury Park. This compensation thing has probably got everybody crazy. It's a thorn in my side for years. Someone starts in your position 20 years ago. Maybe he was making $12 an hour. Well, that's just off the top. He gets some compensation time. It's stacked up. Then all of a sudden, 20 years later, maybe he's making $25 an hour, $30, or whatever the case may be. At the time he retires, he gets what he is making that day. What is wrong with your bookkeeping? To me, that is so unfair. It's killing everybody. That's why everybody's up in arms, in my opinion. With all the technology today, you can't keep books. I don't get that. I really don't. And another thing, exempt personnel are not supposed to get overtime or any of that stuff or comp or whatever. I like to know who is watching the exempt people when they're taking off. Who do they report to? What's the chain of command? No reflection on you, city manager. However, when you're out, who do you say, I'm leaving for the day, and who's keeping records of your time off, or the people under you, or what have you? So I'm not finished. This is just, okay. So this is the kind of like the business aspect of what I'm up here about. Okay. Now on to better things, and you can answer me. You can answer these questions when I'm done.
Thank you.
The city looks beautiful. It's all lit up. Christmas is around the corner. Love it, love it, love it. Came back from Mass at St. Michael's. I happened to run right into smack, right smack in front of me was Deal Police Department. What is in front of Deal Police Department? The manger. I go up the road, and what is over in Allenhurst? A manger. Is there any reason why we don't have a manger, or am I missing something? Now you can answer.
Thank you. It is a sticky situation with any sort of secular mangers, menorahs, anything of that sentiment. My opinion, and I don't know the history of it, is it's better off to do nothing. And there's a lot of municipalities around the state that are just the generic holiday. And I believe in that because there is liability issues. A lot of municipalities have been sued and they lose. So while there is a manger in some places, it just takes one lawsuit and you're paying. So as you just heard about taxes and you're talking about business, I would much rather recommend, let's be generic, where we're not offending everyone or anyone, because we will lose that litigation. Concerning the wages that you mentioned, I agree with you 100%. It has been a problem across the 565 municipalities in the state of New Jersey, where when you start at $12 an hour and you're ending at $28 an hour, you get paid at those $28 an hour. It's part of the union contracts. The union contracts here are up in a couple of years. It's not necessarily a bookkeeping issue, because under the law, payroll records are permanent. So any town can go back and check. Those are permanent records. I agree with you with that. There's only 5 employees in the city who aren't part of the union, myself being one. So when you talked about, you know, exempt versus non-exempt and comp time, the union employees get it because of their contract. Even if you're a director, and I'll be honest with you, that shocked me too, because as a director with supervisory skills under the federal labor laws, you shouldn't get it, but it's a union thing. And When I am out, I'm out. I'm an exempt employee. My job is to get my job done until it gets done. I think the non-union employees are me, the clerk, the fire chief, and the CFO. Every other employee is a member of a union.
And do you all report to each other, I'm out today, or what? How does that work?
Yes.
I mean, you do? I mean, who would be your person of contact to say, I'm not coming in, keep it in my folder or my
time? Well, I don't have time yet, so I can't be out.
Oh, okay.
but right. What will happen, and I had a death in the family, so obviously okay. I couldn't come in. I informed the mayor and council, Cassandra, okay. who, and then also Mr. Nuccio and Mr. Ketty were the deputy managers. And I will tell anyone and everyone this is what it is, and you can still reach me via...
I clearly understand about the sticky situation regarding Christmas, okay? Because Christmas has been around forever. But I'll tell you something, that town of Deal, think about their community, and they have no problem putting up a manger.
I worked in a municipality that actually had live animals in their manger. And
well,
that was, you had animal rights people, that it was well, litigation out the wazoo.
I'm not asking for
well,
that.
Well, I came to work one day and there was a donkey in the front of town hall. I was like, what is this? And it's just the way they always did it. And yeah. I wasn't very thrilled with the okay. live animals sitting in the middle of town
all
hall.
Right,
but
thank you. Here we go again, PC. And you know what got, you know what kind of trouble we got in with that? Over in California. Thank you.
Thank you, Louise.
Maureen Nevin, Deal Lake Drive. I have 3 things if I can barrel through this. This morning there was a lovely ceremony over in Bradley Beach for the 100th anniversary of the Beach Cinema. And they have a really nice museum there. And I noticed in looking at all of these public pools, it was really great to be a kid back before, I think it was 92 when Bradley Beach's pool burned, and I don't know what year our 2 pools at the end of Deal Lake Drive, right, or that area, were taken down. But I just want to throw this out there because something bothered me about this. It seemed that all the kids in the pictures were white, and I thought, does this have something to do with race? Because when the government forced the pools to integrate, the interest to keep the pools going kind of was let go. So that might be something with a current mentality and cultural awareness might want to think about. But in the redevelopment agreement, we had said that the master developer could not build a private pool until they provided a public swimming pool on the waterfront. And I wondered what happened to the status of that. And regardless, what can we do to get a public pool, and maybe more than one, in our community? Secondly, Sackman's parking lot, I've brought this up before, at Webb and Deal Lake Drive, the corner there, it's still an unused lot, and with the demands of parking lately, it's ridiculous to pass it over. I'd like to know what we can do about that. And as far as the exemptions tonight, Asbury Partners LLC, iStar, Asbury Lanes Redevelopment, why is that under contract negotiations? And I would have the same question about the Savoy. Still have 45 seconds.
With regard to the last comment, there are agreements associated with all of those items.
The other thing is the microphones. No one's using their microphone the way you have to in order to be heard back here.
I have mine on. There are agreements that would be associated with each one of those items, and that's why council was reviewing terms and conditions during tonight's executive session.
There are terms? I'm sorry, I didn't follow that.
There would be agreements that would be entered into between the city and those that are seeking the tax exemptions. So.
Oh, this has to do with tax exemptions?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Okay. How about the other two?
I don't know about, I read the, are you talking about the 2002 WRA?
I'm not sure which.
About the pools? Because I don't remember anything
evolution.
In it. That doesn't mean it's not in it. I can certainly take a peruse through. I would be curious, too, if there's something about
it. It was
pools.
In. I mean, when it may have been taken out, I don't know.
All right. So I will, I'll take a look, and then I'll email you back.
Okay,
I
thank you.
I don't think it's been taken out. I just don't see it happening.
Well, let's see if it's
right,
in the agreement first.
I think there's one
first.
Private and one public beach club in there, right?
Beach
that was
club.
Right.
They had to build the public before they could do the private.
Right. We're going to go through the process starting in the new year of looking at all those amendments, and hopefully the goal would be within the year to pass new amendments. So that would be something that we would absolutely look at. Because I do think you're right that there was a private and a public.
Beach club or pool?
Beach club with
pool.
Beach club
okay.
with the pool.
And what about the other part of that question? That some, you know, that we have another one somewhere in the city, regardless of what happens with the redevelopment.
You want us to build a pool?
Yes.
Okay.
Nice.
Where? We don't have any other land.
Well, it looks like you had a lot of vacant land, but I don't know because it doesn't. Not every lot has a sign saying this is the future home of whatever. But
I mean, and just for the record, the Boys and Girls Club does have an indoor pool. I mean, for what that's worth, they do.
I know it's an indoor pool, but it's not city owned.
It is not city owned.
I'm talking city. So, and the last was the corner of Webb and Deer Lake Drive. The lot.
He's still using it for storage, correct?
No, I think. Yeah, the plan was to move it over to the Deal Motel lot, the storage stuff. So I can't see through that fence right now. I haven't looked over there to see if the trailers are still there, but.
I believe they are, and that's where all the lights and everything are being stored for the beachfront. So I believe they're still there in the trailers.
And that's our stuff in that lot?
It's stuff for...
In Sackman's lot?
I don't think that's Sackman's.
Oh, Sackman's. I'm thinking, I'm iStar.
You're thinking of the Deal Motel spot.
Yeah, okay.
No, this is the Webb and Deer Lake Drive.
Webb and
there is a lot. There is definitely a lot.
It was a parking lot at one time, you can tell by the way it's configured.
It's fenced and it's big and empty.
15 years it's been sitting there. It's owned by.
I think that's the one that you and I spoke about in the past.
Yeah.
That's the iStar lot.
It's iStar.
Right. Currently, they did put the fencing around there. What's there now is the trailers where the storage for the boardwalk lights are.
Right.
All right, so that's what's there at this point.
I'm out of the Santander, but I think Maureen's talking about the lot on Deal Lake Drive
right.
near 200 Deal Lake that is completely empty, that has a fence around it.
The lot.
I don't think that is iStar.
I don't know that that's still empty.
Yeah.
There's a little rundown lot on Webb there.
It's big. It's a big lot.
Next to the Miramar. Right?
Yes.
Maureen, is it the one?
No, it's no. I'm talking about Deer Lake Drive and Webb.
Maureen, is
yes.
it
right.
one
exactly.
that I had a discussion about?
Yeah, and you said that they were going to move everything over to the Deal lot.
Right on the corner of Deal Lake Drive and Webb.
Right. And
I
should say the Deal Motel lot.
Yeah,
there's not stores, unless they move that. They didn't have stores set in
there.
There's
trailers there, and that's where they
okay.
have
you know what I moved.
All of that's
going to
be moved
into.
Okay, when is that going to happen? Because we talked about this last summer.
Right now, they're in the midst of erecting the lamps or the lights onto the boardwalk.
Uh huh.
So that's what's being stored there right now.
But, you know, they need to open that lot up.
in order for them to open.
Who is that? Shh. I have the mic.
We can't get them to open downtown lots up.
What's that? I'm sorry.
We can't get Carter to open the downtown lots up.
You can't get what?
You're saying Carter, he's saying iStar, I'm going to drive by tomorrow, so.
Yeah, well, whatever it is, I mean, the parking is needed, and to have it sitting there without any use, I mean, we can negotiate these things.
We'll try, and we'll look into it and get back to you, Maureen. Thank you.
Tracy Rogers, Monroe Avenue. A lot of people brought up the comp time.
What?
The comp time. Is that being controlled now, that department heads and how they allocate comp time and the usage of it? And I'm trying to recollect, I don't know the civil service agreement. Can a city actually go in and request a state that they want to reorganize and actually look at changing departments and then notice to all the employees, and that would structure a change within where you move people and what their salaries are to get a better work usage so everything is going on? Because I'm looking at the ordinance right now, 2015-53, and it talks about amending salaries for certain employees. Could that be covered in a reorganization?
You done?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The salary ordinance actually reduces salaries.
Yeah.
So
okay.
That's that one. With civil service, yes, you can. There's notification process, as you mentioned. You can reorganize any way you really need to or want to, as long as you go through the process. Concerning comp time, yes, it's monitored, and it's actually part of the MOU as a transitional aid municipality. So there's standards that are on it. I don't remember off the top of my head, but comp time is in the MOU, which dictates what can and can't be done.
So all past allocations will be dealt with also? They're going to fix that? And are you thinking about using the restructuring to actually make a government work better for the employees, I mean the residents, and also a better flow on the operation of how the city runs department-wise?
Concerning comp time, what's earned is earned. It's a legal right. You can't take it away. You can't change it. Concerning operations, everything is looked at. That's my job. So it'll take some time. I'm looking at everything. Everyone's looking at everything. And if something happens and something's recommended, it'll be recommended. But as you said, there's a process with it.
Okay.
Motion to close.
Move to close.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, next is acceptance of minutes. We have several sets on this evening. November 9, 2015, workshop session, November 12th, executive session, November 12th, regular session, November 23rd, workshop session, November 24th, executive, and November 24th, regular. Does anybody want any of those minutes removed? Motion to accept all those minutes?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Next is the consent agenda. All matters listed on the consent agenda are presented collectively to the City Council and will be considered for approval with one vote. These matters are considered to be routine in nature, and there will be no individual discussion of these items. If discussion is desired by one or more council members as a particular items, then the item shall be removed to the consent agenda and considered separately. Tonight on the consent agenda is 2015-414, approving special events, wedding applications as presented on December 7, 2015. 2015-415, resolution authorizing payment of payroll in the amount of $876,633.96. 2015-416, award of contract for regional contribution agreement for 9 Ivy Place. 2015-417, award of contract for regional contribution agreement project, 1503 Summerfield Avenue. And 2015-418, authorized submission of grant application to State of New Jersey Department of Public Safety, Division of Highway Traffic Safety under the Drive Sober and Get Pulled Over 2015 Statewide Year End Holiday Crackdown Grant. Does anybody want any of the resolutions removed? Motion to accept.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2015-367, resolution authorizing participation in Section 1033 program for procurement of federal surplus property for the Department of Defense and delegating authority for local administration of participation in the program. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions?
I just wanted to, this has been in front of us a couple times. We had talked about a policy, and I just wanted to thank the city manager for adding language in there that specifically excludes firearms, riot gear, or other equipment of a paramilitary nature or purpose, so that this is just to get us, as it says in here, generators, office equipment, things like that, that'll help the city not to do any of those other things that explicitly excludes. So thank you for that.
Any other comments, questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2015-419, resolution authorizing the payment of bills in the amount of $1,408,906.21.
Motion. Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2015-420, resolution authorizing T&M Associates to proceed with 2015 road improvement program. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Abstain.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2015-421, authorizing the City of Asbury Park to implement the competitive contracting process to procure vendors to operate various concessions within the city. Can I have a motion, please?
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2015-422, authorizing settlement workers' compensation claim caption, Robert Abbott versus the City of Asbury Park. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
On to ordinances. The first reading, ordinance 2015-53, ordinance amending salaries of certain employees within the City of Asbury Park, Monmouth County, New Jersey. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions?
As the city manager indicated, this ordinance actually lowers the range for the position of deputy city manager.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing is scheduled for December 3rd, 2015. Huh? What did I say, 3rd? December 23rd. Ordinance 2015-54, ordinance amending and supplementing subsection 7-37.1 entitled Regulations for the Movement and the Parking of Traffic of Municipal Property and Board of Education Property on section 7-37, Control for Movement and the Parking of Traffic on Public and Private Property per NJSA 39:5A-1 of Chapter 7, Traffic of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions?
I'll just indicate that this ordinance was brought forward at the request of the police department, and it memorializes the reservation of certain parking spaces within the municipal parking lot here for the city manager, the mayor, the deputy mayor, three council persons, and an additional reserved parking space.
Just make me a hard copy, please. I mean, I have, no, what I asked Monday night. I don't see how this ties into the Board of Education. I want to see what spots have already been approved by the Board of Education.
I think the reference to the Board of Education in the title is simply because that's the way the title of that section in the city code reads.
Well, that's stupid. Okay, so I mean, should we correct that while we're doing this?
Is there reserved parking for the Board of Education?
There is a section in there that references other municipal and Board of Education properties, but we can certainly review that, and if there needs to be a revision or something taken out, we can move that forward separately. But this is what's already in the code, and it was just the title. And we're putting this new provision in there about these reserved parking spaces in the area that happens to have that title. But we'll review it to see if a revision should be made.
Okay, you don't have to review it, though. Just make me a hard copy. I'll read it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I can't think of any Board of Education reserve spots in the city. So that's, again, it's just a stupid title. Okay.
Any other comments or questions?
And with regard to Board of Education, it says locations and regulations for other municipal and Board of Education properties may be found on file in the city offices. Now, I don't know that there are any that exist. So it could be just superfluous, and we should potentially just take it out. So we'll take a look at that for a possible future ordinance.
Councilmember Clayton?
Can we table this one, John? I'm not sure about it either. Can we table this one?
No, I think we're better off
the
to
intention
move.
Of the ordinance that's before you tonight is just to memorialize to reserving yeah. those parking
spaces. Well, I'm on the code committee. We'll change the title.
We can deal with the title as Deputy Mayor Quinn indicated as part of the continuing efforts with the codification that's ongoing.
Don't worry about it. Go ahead.
I believe this whole section is being reviewed at the moment.
You will see that the whole traffic section is under review, and we expect that it's going to be brought forward for formal authorization and approval by the City Council early in the year 2016. I know that Officer Fiore has been working with Nancy Hayduck from Coded Systems on that, and that the whole chapter is being revamped and brought forward in early 2016.
When's the whole code going to be done?
Code has already been adopted, but when you adopted the code several months ago, which was the requirement with the change in the form of government that the new council has to adopt a new administrative code, the review of it was primarily on Chapter 2, which dealt with the administrative provisions of the city dealing with the new form of government and positions that were in the city under the heading of administration. The other chapters have been ongoing in the process of being updated, and traffic and safety is the next one that's going to be brought forward.
Okay, so what we had to do, and we're straying off this immensely, I apologize. What we had to do because of the change of government is all done.
It's done. Yes. And basically what you did is you essentially created a new document, a new book that is both in hard copy and available electronically on the city's website. Of course, it had never been accessible previously electronically on the city's website. Now, members of the public can easily access the city code on the city's website, and it incorporates all of the ordinances that had been adopted since the last codification had taken place, which was all the way back in the year 1990. So by approving the new code, you updated it to include all of those ordinances that previously hadn't been available in the printed version. They're all bound together in one complete document, so it makes it much easier to locate ordinances. But the individual review and updating of individual chapters is a task that is ongoing, and the next one coming forward is vehicles and traffic.
Fine. And then can you just let me know how many more are after vehicles and traffic down the road? I mean, we've been, not we, but I mean, councils have been doing, I'm glad everything that had to be done because the change of government is done. Thank you, Pam. Thank Amy and everybody for volunteering. But the codification process has been going on for about like 6 years.
And I believe this is going to be ongoing. It's going to be a continuous process from this point on because you're always going to be continually updating your code. So whatever might fit today might not fit next year. So you're going to continually do this. Traffic is a big section. Traffic is a section that really needed to be reviewed. But I believe most of these sections have already been reviewed, like our fee sections and such. And
part of the process also is you need department heads to sit down, review this, usually meet with Pam. I will say, and I think Pam will back me up, there were some delays with that. No question about that. So it isn't like me, Fred, and Pam sitting there writing up the code. It's us sitting with, or most of the time Pam, sitting with a department head and updating an entire section of code, rereading it. I mean, this isn't like the three of us are like, oh, great. You know, it's okay, an extremely lengthy process.
I just know, and Fred, you can tell me later, how many years you've been working on the recodification. I mean, it's a minimum of 6 years that I'm aware of. And I guess it's like she just said, it's going to be forever. It's going to be every year we're going to be doing something. Mm-hmm. But somebody talking back there about scams, I mean, I don't know.
Maybe you should take my place on the code committee.
But it's not you and some lady we're paying to do this.
Well, she does the final version, but getting, like, for example, we got a new planner, right? So she had a different vision for a number of sections of the code department than Don Samet had. So beyond the regular update, she then had a whole plethora of great changes that she made to the planning code.
Okay.
Anyway.
I've been told this is going to keep on going until forever. Okay.
Any other comments or questions off the beaten path? Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing is scheduled for December 23rd, 2015. We're on now to the second readings. The first one's 2015-47, Ordinance Amending and Supplementing Section 7-20, entitled One-Way Streets of Chapter 7, Traffic of the Code of the City of Asbury Park in New Jersey. Have a motion to open this ordinance up to the public, please.
Move it.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Anybody in the public like to speak about?
How about explaining it?
Get up to the microphone, we'll explain it, Rita.
What?
If you get it, you want to get, ask a question?
Explain it a little better. Nobody knows what you're talking about.
It's making two one-way streets.
Oh. Okay.
It's something that
one-way street.
The police had previously come before the mayor and council at a prior work session and had made a request that the council change two areas from being two-way streets to one-way streets. And they're identified in the ordinance. And
streets?
One is the triangle by the Asbury Tower. You know how you come down Deal Lake Drive, you can kind of go to the right and straight, or you can go all the way around the triangle to get to the fisherman's lot. So that is too narrow to have parking on both sides.
So it's going to be one way going west.
So it's one way going west. So you can do a loop.
And that was also at the request of the seniors of Asbury Towers.
Right.
Correct. And the second one is? What's the second one?
Going north.
On 7th.
North of the tower.
So what does that mean?
The street is north of the tower, but the street would be going west.
One of them is one way east, and one of them is going to be one way north.
It's going east.
As identified in the ordinance.
So then the parking lot is going to be
east. Right, we have to change the. If it's east, it needs to be changed. The lines need to change.
The original thing said west, I
think. Not west, too. Good question.
We'll check with Joel. That was Joel's assessment and recommendation.
That should go east.
Okay.
I was always, yeah, right. But it has to be, no, I think it might have been east, but the lane, the parking, they're all parking the wrong direction. Right? If we're going to go east.
That makes no sense.
But you got to change them. So we have to ask Joel about that if it's you know what I mean.
Is there something that you want to clarify with the police department before you adopt the ordinance? You could table it.
So we'll table it.
Do we have to table it, or can you just clarify if it goes east? Are we going to change?
I recommend tabling.
I Joel reached out to me, questioning about fire apparatus response and whatnot, and his intent was one way east because we did have the conversation that the angled parking would have to be restriped.
Okay.
So Joel's intent was one way east.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
So the ordinance as written is correct in accordance with the recommendation from the police department.
Correct.
Traffic will be going in an easterly direction, yes. One way.
Warner?
Hello. Warner Baumgartner, Fifth Avenue. I just have a suggestion. If you're going to start rearranging streets and changing directions and things, you might want to consider something a little more comprehensive. In particular, this one you're discussing about whether it's east or west, there's this bump out that comes out that prevents you from actually just driving across Kingsley to get to that road. You drive into a curb. Why not get rid of the bump out and just make it a straight run right down to the oceanfront like it used to be? It's an extension of Deer Lake Drive, essentially, is what that road is. I've heard it called a unnamed road. It's Deer Lake Drive, simply extended from Kingsley to Ocean. Except some years ago, this weird triangular bump out was created there that prevents you from just crossing straight over. That's what you really ought to look at. So, there you go.
Thank you.
And the second street, Rita, is Park Hall Place, the little one-way street over here, two-way street behind the post office, parallel to the railroad tracks between Summerfield Avenue and Monroe. That's going to be one-way going north.
Move it.
Close the...
Motion to close.
Yeah.
Second. Motion to adopt ordinance 2015-47.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-48, amending and supplementing section 2-10.1, entitled Voluntary Special Duty Assignments for Police Officers and Firefighters of Section 2-10 of Special Duty Assignments of Chapter 2 Administration of the Code of the City of Asbury Park. Motion to open ordinance 2015-48 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
Anybody wish to speak regarding ordinance 2015-48? Motion to close.
Move it.
Second. Motion to adopt ordinance 2015-48.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-49, ordinance amending and supplementing section 4-1, titled Business Licenses of Chapter 4 General Licensing of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Motion to open 2015-49 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
Anybody wish to speak? Motion to close.
Move to close.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2015-49.
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-50, ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 2 entitled Administration of the City Code of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey, in order to establish a new section thereof to be known as Section 2-86, entitled Requests which require services to be rendered by the professional appointed and or employed by the city, application procedure and escrow requirement. Motion to open 2015-50 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
Anybody wish to speak?
Could you explain that paragraph?
Right.
This ordinance memorializes the city's right to request certain applicants the right or the it memorializes our ability to get escrow from them to cover fees of city professionals. So, for instance, these are not necessarily items that fall under the land use and zoning chapter of the code, which already have escrow requirements associated with them. But we've had, on occasion, applicants who've come forward who've asked for the ability to utilize areas of the city's right of way, and that requires the council to have an agreement put together between the property owner and the city, and there are fees associated with that the city shouldn't absorb. They should be the responsibility of those that are requesting the agreement from the city. So at the request of the finance department of the city, we put together this ordinance that memorializes the terms and conditions associated with the city requesting escrow from private applicants. so that they are paying for the services as opposed to the taxpayers.
Mm-hmm. How does the escrow work?
It'll work like any other escrow account. It'll be set forth separately under the applicant's name through the finance department, and the minimum amount of the deposit is $500. It depends on the scope of services, and the finance department and the city manager will make a final determination as to the amount that's required based upon the scope of what's required.
The owner of the property, or is that?
It's the applicant, whoever's making a request of the city.
So
it could be an owner of a business, or it could be an owner of a property or a business owner that is a tenant who is requesting something from the city that requires city professionals to either review or prepare documents, and the intention was to make sure that the taxpayers weren't absorbing those fees. Mm-hmm.
I just got to correct you. I don't think the finance department asked for that. The mayor and council asked for this. Because
you had requested it, right. But the finance department wanted to make sure that it was codified in ordinance form.
Okay, fine. It's done legally. But, I mean, this is something to help to try to reduce taxes down the road by making the people who are asking to pick up the engineering fees, the lawyer's fees, the architect's fees, everything. Why should me living on 4th Avenue pick up something for Cookman Avenue? So you want to apply for a vestibule for the winter time, you're going to pay all going rate. So again, most towns already had it. We're a little bit late, but better late than never. Thank you.
Motion to postpone.
Thank you.
Second?
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2015-50?
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-51, ordinance establishing a 15-minute time limit for a single parking space along 2nd Avenue in the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey, amending and supplementing the revised general ordinances of the City of Asbury Park accordingly. Motion to open the ordinance to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Anybody wish to speak?
The address.
So this is on the 2nd Ave by the Asbury Roastery.
Who? Asbury Roastery.
Asbury
Rita,
Roastery.
The coffee
so
shop.
Because we don't have metered parking there, people just park on those spots and never move their cars. This is the what people call the high cost of free parking. And the business owner requested that we have a 15-minute spot. So there's just one spot for her customers to come into and pick up coffee and supplies and leave.
We don't put an address because it's not exactly in front of an address, because the police department measures 70 feet from here, blah, blah, blah. So it could be 805 and 3/4. But it's on the 800 block on the north side of the street.
And there's a legal description that's included in the ordinance that specifically identifies exactly where that spot is going to be.
Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2015-51.
Move it.
Second.
Second. Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-52, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 30 Land Development Regulations of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Motion to open 2015-52 to the public?
Move it.
Second.
Any public comment?
Could you explain that?
Yes,
that would take all night.
I can try to give an overview of this. Yes. One. This was at the request of the new city planner. She had appeared previously before the mayor and council at a work session and had set forth in more detail exactly what changes she was suggesting to the land use code. And overall, this ordinance will incorporate increases in application and escrow fees that will be implemented for land use and zoning matters. Also, additional city professionals are being added to be covered by escrow deposits falling squarely under the land use and zoning section of the city code. There are also some revisions that are being made to the city's existing fence ordinance in order to clarify placement adjacent to the property line, clarifying the zones where certain regulations are applicable, incorporating drainage requirements, and making certain additional revisions that were deemed appropriate by the city planner. And it also updates and revises all of the checklists that are required under the New Jersey Municipal Land Use Law for the Planning and Zoning Board, including those for final major subdivision, minor subdivision, major site plan, minor site plan, and variance applications.
Motion to close?
Move it. Second.
Hold on.
In reading this, it seemed like the larger development paid less in fees on one particular page, if I could find it, than the smaller. Here, it's on page 3, I guess, under fees, Exhibit A, site plan review. It says minor development, residential 200, non-residential 200, major development, residential preliminary review 200.
2,000.
Yeah, but if you look up here, no, I'm talking about the application fee.
Right.
Right. So the minor is, yeah.
No, I think the difference where, because the escrow fee is the real big thing, so it's,
yeah,
200 plus the 50 per unit,
which, right,
bumps up because you've got a big unit, so we're hitting them for 50 every additional unit, and then on top of that, it's double.
So but they didn't pay
the escrow, plus the, and I'm, it's been a while since I looked at this, plus the 100 per every 1,000 square feet. So they're getting hit with higher costs, and they're getting hit with per foot or per unit cost as well.
So they didn't pay that that $50 per unit application fee before?
No.
No. Just seemed like, you know, you could squeeze something more than that 200 out, but.
It's a step in the right direction.
What's that?
It's a step in the right direction.
Yeah, you're right.
All right, Ms. Kendall, still move to close.
Move to close.
Second.
Before you move the ordinance, I did want to bring up one item. Michelle Alonzo, our city planner, made a recommendation for a non-substantive amendment.
The property line amendment?
Yes. And
that's fine.
It's under the fencing section, mm-hmm, and it's under section 30-63.1A, and it deals with any fence or wall shall be located at least 1 foot removed from the nearest edge of a, and it previously said sidewalk, and her suggestion was that we change the word sidewalk to property line. And in an email that she sent to me, she said, I recommend changing the word sidewalk to property line tonight. It means the same thing because of the definition of sidewalk in our sidewalk ordinance. So it's not a substantive change. It's the same thing based on the definitions that are in our code. But to a layperson views a sidewalk as being something different. So that will clarify it and remove any confusion. So I recommend that a motion and a second be made to amend the ordinance to make that revision and voted on to revise the ordinance accordingly, and then have the ordinance finally adopted with a separate vote.
I make a motion to amend the ordinance.
And I second. Councilmember Payton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Now, can I have a motion to adopt
the ordinance as amended?
As amended.
I move to adopt as amended.
Second. Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Warner?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn?
So I was just going to say one thing. I should have said it during public comment. I wanted to thank Jackie Pappas in the chamber for doing the tree lighting downtown. While I missed it, I saw pictures and it looked like a lot of great fanfare.
Yes, it was great.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? All right. Close.